Now that we have finally finished dealing with the delta potentials, there is one final potential that we have to work with. And when we are done with that, we will have dealt with all of the potentials that you usually see in an introductory quantum mechanics course. There is still, we still have to deal with three-dimensional potentials, but that is what we will do after we're finished with this. So the final case is the case of the finite square well. Now we had to leave this for last because although it is somewhat similar, at least in the concept, to what we saw in the infinite square well, you will see that this is actually a lot harder, so that's why we left it for last. So the finite square well is a potential that is as follows. It's going to be some negative amount minus V0, as long as we are in some range. Now, obviously this range might be anything, but we are going to do it like this. We're going to call it between minus A and A. And anywhere else, this potential is going to be zero. So basically, whenever this absolute value of X is going to be greater than A. Okay, so what this is going to mean then, when we sketch this, is that the finite square well, this is a kind of potential that looks somewhat like this. So potential as a function of x, and this is going to be minus a, and this is going to be a. So let us now, I'm going to use red actually. So it's going to be some well, and the depth is going to be minus V0. So now, why did we choose to call this minus a and a? Well, obviously this could be displaced in the x directions anywhere. It's just a coordinate system. The result has to be equivalent. So in theory, we could have started between zero and some amount 2a, for example. But the whole idea of choosing our coordinate system to be zero right in the middle of this finite square well is because then our potential is going to be even. You can see it directly from this graph, and if not, you can go ahead and just check it out yourself. But this is an even potential. So that means that when we begin to look for the bound states and the scattering states, then this can actually be very, very useful to us. Okay, so that is what we are going to be dealing with in the next few videos, just as I did in the case for the double delta potential function. What we will do is that I'm going to make two videos out of this. One video is I'm just going to brute force my way through this. I'm not going to use the fact that the potential is even, just in case you forget how to do that and to make sure that you all know how to do it. And then the second video, I am going to use that the potential is even so that the work is easier. That way you can see either of the two options, and in case that is useful to you, then well, you will have it available. So that is it for now. I will see you in the next video.